about this variation in the entropy parameter and how we can use it to predict the crystal structures in multi-component alloys. Of course, there are other schemes which are available out there. I mean, simple valence electron concentration is one way forward, but it fails in certain cases. It's a good scheme when you want to simply start with something without getting into much detail, but it valence electron concentration criteria fails in certain cases. So at least this criteria provides you with understanding about the deeper understanding about the what exactly is going on into these materials, because you can never know that in a cobalt, chromium, iron, nickel, the body centrocubic phase will form. Okay. Anyway, now with this we move to the. If you remember in this in one of the slides where I showed about, we started with property, what kind of crystal structure we need to. I mean, property was on the top, and then we talked about the structure which the system might be having, and then the composition was there. Now, in the context of property, and say if we are talking about something where we need to have a strength, then we talk about the strength. In the strength of the material is basically more fundamentally decided by the dislocation glide, the way the dislocation glide takes place in the system. Now, if the dislocation glide, when dislocation glide takes place through the system, if it is going to be that difficult. In the case where it's going to be difficult, in those cases you might be seeing higher strength. Of course, in very idealized cases I'm talking about. Okay, so I think I should write about it. In this part, the discussion which you are having was the strength of a candidate alloy. Okay. Now, the strength of the particular alloy, of course, it is going to be dependent on various things which can happen. But let's, for the simple cases, we can think in terms of the it is the movement of dislocation crystal lattice, it's an important thing. I mean, crystal lattice is just a mathematical entity, but it's basically the movement of dislocation line through the disordered system which we are just talking about. It's basically going to influence the strength of the candidate alloy. There are other things, because as you remember that we showed you microstructures. So in those microstructures you saw there were grains and there were associated grain boundaries. So that are also, again, with the grain boundary strengthening, how ultimately that is going to influence. So again, there are many things which can happen. Dislocation also can interact with another dislocation that is also going to have a lot of contributions. So for the time being, let's just think about just a simple dislocation moving along the crystal lattice. So the people who don't know, the dislocation is nothing but it is a line defect when you have a rows of atom basically missing, and in that case what basically happens, that if, and it can take place due to the deformation or due to the processing, various processing considerations, you have these missing rows and you form this line defect in the material, and this line defect moves inside the material under the influence of the external stress. So we tend to suppose we draw the dislocation, I mean, it's just atomic planes like that. I mean, I'm just drawing a simple thing for you. Suppose I'm just drawing this for the people who have not studied it earlier. So suppose from there these atoms are missing from, say, this particular point. In that case, what is going to happen? So let's. So you have some missing atoms beyond this point. So what is ultimately going to happen? That these planes will ultimately basically shift. I mean, these planes will basically shift. Okay, I'm very bad in drawing, so apologies for that. The point is that due to this is a phenomena, what is going to happen, that there is going to be development of stresses in the system, and these stresses are going to basically, of course, there is going to be the energy associated with the dislocation core itself. So this part where you have basically this dislocation line goes inside through this particular the plane of the screen. Basically, I cannot show you over here, but the point which I want to make over here is that these kind of line defects are very crucial in the context of the development of the strength of these high entropy alloys, or any alloy that per se. The point is, in context of high entropy alloys, this becomes more important, because what happens that in ideal cases, these atoms are basically sitting at their lattice point very nicely. I mean, earlier we drew, I mean, and then in the plane of the screen, basically there is a row of atoms. So basically, what I want to say over here is that in general binary or a simple kind of alloys, what you find that these atoms are basically nicely sitting at their equilibrium lattice point. So the dislocation basically, as it moves through the lattice, it basically encounters certain barriers in the movement. I mean, generally, if you are talking about the barriers in conventional alloys, what is going to happen that these barriers generally are symmetric. But if these atoms start to move away, I mean, I'm not drawing these, but they start to move away from their lattice points, what is going to happen that the barriers, the dislocation which is going to encounter, they are going to be certainly asymmetric kind of thing. But how do this distortion take place? So having this understanding about this distortion in metallic system is a very important question, because we know that they sit at their lattice point, and if they move away from their lattice point, then there is going to be some interesting thing happening. Okay, with this question in mind, with obviously our big target that how the strength of this material is being decided, now we are thinking about that what basically influences the distortion in these kind of transition metal alloys or high entropy alloys. Because in high entropy alloys, this was one of the hypotheses that there is a severe distortion at the atomic scale which lead to the movement of dislocation difficult in the system, and hence the strength of this material increases and other deformation modes comes up into the picture. We are not getting into that. So the question which we have clear in our mind at this stage is how the distortion take place. Okay, so with this we move to the next part. So what approach we use? We know that this five component case, let's talk about the face center cubic, cobalt, chromium, iron, manganese, nickel. This is a five component case which we are talking about. So it is in a face center cubic form. Now, any atom can be at any point, and there is certain distortion, deviation of atoms from this ideal lattice point. But if we start to study everything in parallel, then development of understanding about a phenomena becomes difficult. So let's start with something which is called the impurity in matrix approach, where we are generating all these five components, that is cobalt, chromium, iron, manganese, nickel, a face center cubic lattice, and it's and another lattice which we are generating, which is a ground state for the atom. Say for cobalt, the ground state crystal structure is hexagonal closed pack. So in that case, we are generating the hexagonal closed pack cobalt, face center cubic cobalt, and are introducing other elements in the center of the supercell. Okay, so we are generating a it's in a way this other atom is acting as an input and seeing which case we are seeing the significant distortion. As you can see straight over here that in the face center chromium, if you introduce these other elements, which is the iron, manganese, nickel or cobalt, what you start to see that there is a significant distortion, and this distortion is being quantified in terms of the bond length range which exists in this particular case. So we found that in the case of say when the matrix is chromium in a face center cubic lattice, we find significant distortion happening due to these elements in comparison to all the other cases. Of course, we are interested what is happening in the context of the face center cubic cases, because this Cantor alloy exists in the face center cubic form. We want to develop our understanding that why this distortion take place, because once you have understanding about that why distortion take place, then you can engineer the distortion to basically engineer the strength associated with the material. Okay, because you remember, if the dislocation moves through the lattice, it is this distortion which basically changes the potential energy landscape associated with the system. So what we did, we carry out the, as we saw, I just mentioned the density functional theory calculations for these in impurity and in matrix approach, and we started to look into how the charge transfer is taking place, what kind of charge transfer is taking place in the system, what is the magnetic moment associated with these elements as they are there. And what we realized that in the cases when we are seeing the significant in this case what we I'm plotting what is the value of the charge, Mulliken charge, which is one of the way by which you represent the charge associated with a particular atom through the DFT calculations. And what is the magnetic moment associated with these impurities when they are in the matrix? What we find that in all of these cases, what's basically happening that basically these impurities are now, they're gathering up some charge to, some fractional charge is basically being transferred from the chromium atom towards these impurities. Okay, so that is another understanding which we gradually started to develop, that okay, this is what is happening. And in few of the cases, there is a very minimal magnetic moment associated with these impurities, but in some cases there is a tendency for anti-ferromagnetic alignment of these impurity atoms associated with the chromium in a face center cubic form. So that is again another observation which we made. What to do with that observation? So if what we started to see that this Mulliken charge doesn't provide you very, you know, very precise understanding about the charge transfer which can take place, we started to look into something very interesting which is called the Bader charge. Bader charge provides you much more robust understanding about the partitioning of charge between various atoms. So for the moment you can understand this, but this thing which you can understand also, that in this case what is happening, that these impurities which are there in the face center cubic chromium, even though they are accumulating the charge on them, but the volume associated with these elements is basically going down. So you imagine that you are sitting on the face center cubic lattice in the center of the supercell surrounded by chromium, and due to the electronic effect you are getting more electrons partially, but your size is not increasing. Rather, what you're seeing that your size is basically shrinking, so volume shrinks. So that volume shrink when take place, then these other atoms which are on your nearest neighbor, they are basically coming together. So this volume shrink and this movement of atom is basically leading to the distortion in the system. Okay, so this is another observation which we made. Now, if the magnetism is playing very crucial role here, because I mentioned to you that what we found that there is some anti-ferromagnetic alignment of these elements when they are in the face center cubic chromium. That is what we found, that if you constrain the system to be ferromagnetic, of course the distortion goes away. And in addition to that, the magnetic moment goes up and this charge disproportion is also minimized. So I mean, you can do these kind of calculations in density functional theory where you can force the system to be ferromagnetic. So all the atoms, their magnetic moment are basically aligned in the same direction. And after doing so, the discrepancy or the volume shrink, which we are discussing about, that also goes away. That is in the, sorry, this is in the Bohr. This is not in the angstrom. Okay, so with this, we could see that this distortion have, the magnetism is basically influencing the distortion in this kind of system, particularly the kind of alloys we are talking about. Mind it, at this stage, we're just doing this, developing our understanding about the these alloys were simple impurity in matrix calculation. Even though we are not yet got into the kind of calculations where you're talking about all the five components together, you can imagine how interesting and challenging it would be. Now, initially, we wanted to see that why that, what is exactly happening if you look that there are conduction electrons surrounding it. And say, if you talk about this face centered nickel, if you put a cobalt over there, it's all, they're all generally, I mean, ferromagnetic, you don't see much. Of course, in the context of impurity atom, it attains certain magnetic moment, which is higher in comparison to other, but you don't see anything interesting. So if you track along this particular line, which I've just drawn, and see what is the magnetic moment, you don't see anything interesting happening. But in the context of face-centered chromium matrix, when you put cobalt there, you start to see very interesting things. What we did, we tracked through it, and what we found that the magnetic moment basically fluctuates in the interstitial region. So basically conduction electrons, which are there, they are fluctuating in a way. And this was very interesting because once you force the system to be ferromagnetic, this kind of fluctuation goes away. Now to realize that this kind of fluctuation, we also played around with a face-centered cubic manganese. This is a very interesting case because the manganese is a very complicated magnetic material. What happens that if you initiate the calculations from a different parts of the potential energy landscape by putting different kind of magnetic moments on the manganese and chromium, you reach to different possibilities. And this is a very interesting thing because it happens due to the inherent complexity of the face-centered cubic manganese might also be due to the, inherent limitation of even DFT. You see, we are using in DFT, we are doing a lot of calculations, but there are obviously approximations in the DFT calculations also. So if some of you who might be interested in carrying out the DFT calculations, but just by thinking that no struggles there, but even in that path, there are approximations such as exchange correlation functionals and all, I'm sure about which you will be told in the later classes. But one observation, even in the context of manganese, is very clear. In the face-centered cubic case, when we are introducing the impurity, the distortion was taking place between the impurity and the chromium bond. But the chromium-chromium bond was fine. But in manganese, suppose it happens, it is the manganese-manganese bond where a lot of interesting things happen. As I am showing in two cases, one is a high magnetic moment case and another is a low magnetic moment case. In these cases, what we find that the magnetic moment associated with these varies, I mean, depending upon from which part of the potential energy landscape you're starting, I mean, how you're initializing your calculation. But the case where we are seeing the manganese-manganese bond interaction, again, this fluctuation in the conduction electron remains. And this is what we saw. I mean, that what you're seeing, that this distortion, again, the Bader volume are significantly different in context of high spin case where we also see the distortion, but the manganese-manganese distortion is limited when the low magnetic moment cases are there. Okay, so this is another very interesting observation which came out of it. So what we started to do, we expanded and we contracted this system to see whether these fluctuations are coming about due to that. And of course, one is the equilibrium part, and you see such fluctuation happening in certain contraction of room. I mean, when you contract a super lattice, you see certain fluctuation happening, but no conclusive things were coming out. Again, when you are carrying out this kind of expansion and contraction, this delta parameter, which is the volume shrink, which we just discussed earlier, it remains more or less constant. So this is something which has got to do with something interesting happening at the about the conduction electrons. So if we really wanted to study the conduction electrons and how they behave, we started to plot the Fermi surface associated with it. And the interesting thing which we saw, that of course the Fermi surface, which is the highest energy which these conduction electrons can have, I mean, the chromium have a very complicated but yet a very beautiful Fermi surface, where they have some kind of they form some kind of concentric layer. As you remember, if you peel up an onion, it is like that. So such behavior in the context of chromium is known. And when the Fermi surface sections are parallel to each other, this phenomena is called the Fermi surface misting. Now we are coming from the distortion, charge transfer, magnetism, and now we are studying the behavior of these conduction electrons through the Fermi surface. And what we realize that they're parallel to each other, or which in physics they call Fermi surface nesting is there. Is it related to the distortion? Because so far whatever we have done, we have to use the information which is available over here to ultimately design the material. And what we found, that you can basically study this nesting of the Fermi surface in terms of certain response function. I'm not getting into detail of that, but the only point which I want to mention at this stage is that that value of that response function, which basically corresponds to the how parallel these Fermi surfaces are. So if Fermi surfaces are really parallel, then the value of that response function will be high. If they are intersection in the Fermi surfaces, then the value associated with that response function would be less. And we plotted it with respect to distortion, but found that there is a linear correlation between the distortion in the materials and these kind of response function. Now, why we are discussing about all this? Because then you can, instead of running full DFT with all the force minimization, you can run simple single point energy, electronic minimization, and you can determine these kind of response function, and you can predict the distortion. And if you can predict the distortion, then you can predict the variation in the potential energy landscape which might take place, and then you can predict the dislocation behavior, which I have not discussed today due to paucity of time. But then from that behavior you can predict the strength. So in this class we have discussed about subparts of the two crucial issues associated with the inverse design of materials. If you are going back, so if you have to go back computationally, you have to really study the individual phenomena. And so far we have not discussed a few more things, which concerns with how we can basically study these phenomena in context of a generic parameter. Okay, you are studying something at the atomistic scale, you are studying something at the ab initio scale, you are studying something at the meso scale. How ultimately you are going to bring all this together to ultimately develop the structure property correlation? So that is something which is still going on, and hopefully we will have some interesting things about this in the future. I'm not saying conclusion, but the outlook, I've just shown you some case studies that how these computational approaches can be employed to study various mechanisms important to development of structure property correlation in materials. And this development of these multi-scale models, ultimately for this if we want to develop this inverse material design, it requires the collaboration between this multidisciplinary team of researchers. Because if you might be a metallurgist, you might be a chemical engineer, you might be a computer scientist, mathematician, it requires the understanding and development of collaborative work is required, so that ultimately you target a problem to reach some kind of convergence, if I may say. And I'm just showing you this abstract figure where we are thinking about that you can develop some multi-scale model. Now, instead of moving from one scale to another, you can you can think of range of models which you can employ to basically study the structure property correlation associated with the material, where you can have a high precision, computationally expensive process. You can have a low precision, high throughput process, and all these things basically interact in real time with each other. And if they interact, various models, if they interact in real time with each other, again, the challenges in those cases remain that how you are basically going to transfer the information between these various fields while keeping your eye on the errors which might be building up in your system. But again, this can be talked independent of itself. I think I should stop over here, and I would like to acknowledge my collaborators, Marcus Eisenbach within ORL, and my PhD supervisors, Colin and Russell, with whom I started this. Thank you. If you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer.
Thank you so much, Professor Gautam Anand. Okay, thank you so much for your nice talk, and thank you for accepting my invitation.
It's my pleasure.
It's a very nice talk. Okay, we'll really like your presentation and all those things. So any participant has any question, please raise your hand. Any doubt, anything, so you can interact with speaker. I think nobody has any question. Generally, they do not have any question. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you. It was a pleasure to be here, and it's a pleasure to present my work. If anyone have any questions, and they can contact me later also, because they can drop me an email.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, see you again.